You've come back for the second part of our dealing with Paul's letters to the Corinthians. And as you can see on the slide ahead of you, that's indeed where we are. We covered 1 Corinthians last week, the last time we were together. And when we did 1 Corinthians, we talked a little bit about the background of Corinth itself, right? To give us a little bit of a background with regard to both of these letters. So I'm trusting that tonight, as we get into 2 Corinthians, we will do just a tiny little bit of review, but we're not going to go through all of it again, and that your memories are good, and you'll understand and see how 2 Corinthians contributes to the New Testament corpus and Paul's letters as they are preserved for us together. So, last week we dealt with 1 Corinthians. Let's start talking about 2 Corinthians, and when we begin this letter, this is what we would call the most personal of Paul's writings, okay? Of all of the letters that we have preserved for us in the New Testament, this is where Paul, I guess, is the most open about himself, about some of the issues that he's dealing with or the struggles that he's having and questions that he has, and this is the letter to help us get to know Paul a little better, okay, as he deals with the Corinthians. It's filled with personal testimonies. In fact, it has been called the defense of his life. The reason why we've called 2 Corinthians that is because it's here where Paul does most of his work on defending his apostleship. If you remember when we were talking about it in 1 Corinthians last time, there were some people in Corinth that were challenging Paul's apostleship. It's this second letter that we have where Paul takes some time to defend his apostleship, and we'll see where that comes in a little later on as we get into the letter a little more deeply. But before we do that, let's talk about how we're going to outline this second letter. 13 chapters, okay? So if you were to do 2 chapters a day, on the 7th day you'd only have 1 chapter left, okay? So easy to work through in a week. But I've taken the 13 chapters, divided them up into 3 sections. The first being the major section that we would talk about, the first 7 chapters. Okay, this is where Paul gives his defense of his conduct and his concern. He talks with the Corinthians about their questions with regard to his apostleship. He talks about how he has dealt with them and the way in which he has worked with them. Remember, his first letter was rather at times harsh about the things that they were not doing or were doing that they weren't supposed to be doing. And so he talks in these chapters about his conduct with them, his concern for them. And then chapters 8 and 9, he talks about the defense of the collection. Here's where Paul talks about their ability and talks with them about their opportunity to give toward the collection that is going to be set off to the poor church members in Jerusalem. Okay, so chapters 8 and 9, this is where Paul talks about giving, talks about the collection, and then chapters 10 through 13, he takes some time to talk about his call to apostleship, how God has called him to the ministry that he has. So that's Paul's letter to, or second letter to the Corinthians, divided up into 3 sections, all where he's dealing with the defense of something, all right? Again, his most personal of the letters that we have. So let's talk a little bit about the background of 2 Corinthians, and how we're going to do this time is we're going to take a look at the biographical setting. Here's where we do just a tiny little bit of review with 1 Corinthians, but this helps us in our biographical setting to kind of understand where this letter comes in the sequence of letters that he writes and what's happening in Paul's life during these days and this time. So, when we talk about the background of the 2 Corinthian letter, we know that it is closely involved with the first, even though we know there's more than one letter, or more than 2 letters that he wrote to Corinthians, but we only have 2 preserved for us. Remember, the founding of the Corinthian church was during Paul's second missionary journey, right? AD 50 is when Paul arrived in Corinth to begin his ministry there, and Acts chapter 18, the first 18 verses, cover that incident for us if we want more detail. And we estimate that Paul was probably around 50 years old at the time that he was doing this. And so don't let anybody ever tell you that ministry is only for the young, right? Ministry is also for those of us who have reached the, shall we say, the more advanced stage of life. I'm not going to call it old Clark because I'm in this stage now, and so that's why I'm not calling it old, right? He was about 50 years old, and Paul remained at Corinth for about 18 months. He was at that time living with Aquila and Priscilla. You might be familiar with those two names. Luke mentions those in his Acts of the Apostles. And while he was there for those 18 months, he was working part-time in the tent-making business to support his evangelistic ministry. Paul was one that did not receive any support for his ministry. He raised his own support, and doing part-time tent-making ministry was how he made his income. He arrives then in Ephesus on his third missionary journey. We estimate the time period of that was about 2 years after he arrived in Corinth. Remember, 18-month ministry in Corinth. Then he moved on to the city of Ephesus. It's here in Ephesus where Paul writes his first letter to the Corinthians. Okay? So it's in Ephesus and he writes his first letter. Shortly after, some 6 months probably, after he has been in Corinth and toward the end of his mission when he does that. Now, let's remember again, as we talked about last week, remember, Paul had these two contacts with the Corinthian church before writing his first letter that's preserved for us from Ephesus. Reason why he did this? Well, remember, he had a short visit with them to combat an incipient opposition to the apostles' ministry, right? Some of the Corinthians were challenging his apostolic authority, and so he was needing to deal with that, as well as some other evils that were taking place in the Corinthian church. And he also talks again about a letter that he writes to them that was referred to in 1 Corinthians 5:9. Let's just remind ourselves of that one. We talked about it last week, but remember, he said, "I wrote to you in my epistle not to keep company with sexually immoral people." And so he refers to a letter that we have no recollection of or collection of because it was not preserved for us. After his arrival in Ephesus, during this third missionary journey, what Paul embarks on now is a 3-year teaching and evangelistic ministry in the city of Ephesus itself. Okay, so he spent 18 months in Corinth. After that, he spends 3 years in Ephesus, and he teaches there. He does some evangelism there. That's all during his third missionary journey, and this not only included fruitful ministry, but it also included severe trials as well, trials that only Paul would endure. It was shortly after this, then, that Paul writes this, what we call, painful letter. His painful letter to the church. The painful letter to which church? The painful letter to the church at Corinth. Why was it a painful letter? Because he challenges them directly about some of the things that they were doing in the church and not taking care of there. After then, his departure from Ephesus, after being there 3 years, he does some ministry at Troas, but that ministry was discontinued because Paul was looking for Titus and he couldn't find him. For a while, Titus was missing. This was a major concern to Paul, such concern that he did not continue his ministry at Troas. But then from there, we find that Paul went on to Macedonia to do ministry there. And here's where Titus then arrives from Corinth with some mixed news with Paul with regard to what's happening in Corinth. In other words, Titus was the messenger from the church in Corinth to Paul. It's going to be Titus that will take this second letter that Paul writes and take it back to Corinth, along with the collection, okay, that will be taken care of and given to the poor in the Jerusalem church. So, the mixed news that Titus had for Paul was about the spiritual awakening that was taking place in the Corinthian church, but also the problems that were still existing in the church. So even after Paul wrote his first letter, there were still some things that they were needing to deal with. Basically, what Titus was doing was giving a report to Paul as to the progress of what happened in the church since Paul's contact with them last. It's here in Macedonia where Paul writes 2 Corinthians. All right? He's writing this from Macedonia. And the reason why he does this is because he's planning a third visit now to the church at Corinth. And so this second letter is to help pave the way for this visit. It will be Paul's final visit to Corinth with 3 months of ministry that he would do there. So the first time he was there, he spent about 18 months with him. He's only there about 3 months this time. And it's here in Corinth where Paul will write Romans. Remember, we've already dealt with Romans. That was the first of Paul's letters that we dealt with. It's here during his third visit to Corinth, during his time in Macedonia, where he is writing his letter to the Romans. And it was also here that Paul escaped a plot against his life. Somebody had it out for him, somebody had a contract on his head, and Paul escapes a plot against his life, and he continues then from there on to Jerusalem. So with this biographical setting of 2 Corinthians, this helps us to understand a little bit now of what's happening in Paul's life. And we could probably say this, that Paul's life was not boring, seemed to be rather busy, seemed to be rather exciting at times, although some excitement he probably didn't want. And Paul was having major effect in ministry during these missionary journeys. Any questions or thoughts before we go on a little further?
Was Paul suffering with having a little pride issues?
Well, you know, there's a possibility there. He talks about it in chapter 12 of this letter, remember? When he talks about the thorn in the flesh, right? And he talks and deals with that thorn in the flesh, he labels it, right? He says it's a messenger from Satan, right? To keep me from being prideful, to keep me humble, right? Mm-hmm. And so that may have been an issue. I mean, some people accused Paul of that. Some, especially in Corinth, accused Paul of that. That's why they challenged his authority and his apostolic authority. They were using some of that to challenge him. Now, Paul would have been the first one used of God that perhaps had a pride problem. Who's another one in the scriptures that we come across that probably had some pride issues as well, but yes, was mightily used to God? We think of Moses. Moses was one that from time to time had to deal with pride issues, right? Again, we see the clear humanity, right, of the human condition, even in the scriptures, are these ones that God uses mightily. That should be an encouragement to us, right? Because if God can use Paul, if God can use Moses with the foibles that they have, guess what God can do with me and my foibles, right? God isn't expecting his servants to be perfect. He's expecting his servants to be faithful. Understand the difference. And that's what was happening with Paul. Any other thoughts or comments here?
But like Titus went off to the other churches to big money or encourage or whatever he was back. When these prophets were traveling, would they normally have somebody to do that? And how would they go by themselves, like for safety's sake? How would they do this?
It would depend on the issues and the circumstances. Sometimes they would travel by themselves, sometimes they'd have people accompanying them on the journey. And often during this time, the reason for their traveling was because they were transporting letters back and forth, okay? Wasn't like what we have today, whereby if we want to communicate with somebody across the miles, we don't even use the post office anymore. What do we use? We use our telephones, or we use our smartphones, or we use our computers, right? With email and texting and all the rest of that. Communication in these days was handled on foot, okay? And the mail system was handled that way. And so a lot of these ones that we find that Paul mentions, his companions that he mentions, are ones that would have traveled with him or have been messengers that he used to transport letters back and forth to churches. Okay.
I think that time for safety.
No, traveling during those days was much more treacherous, perhaps, than even our day and age because of the fact that people who were traveling were easy targets, right? And they would have to bring everything with them. There wasn't the conveniences that we have now on those roads as they traveled. So, yeah, easy marks, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So then, let's talk about the writing then of 2 Corinthians. We've talked about a little bit of Paul's biographical sketch there to help us understand the circumstances surrounding the writing of this letter. Let's talk about the letter itself. And as far as date of writing is concerned, we're talking AD 56 and 57, depending on how soon after 1 Corinthians this letter was written. But not very long. If 1 Corinthians was written in AD 55, then 2 Corinthians was only about a year or two later. And again, as we mentioned before, the place that it was written was in Macedonia, when Paul was there. Now, the original readers of this letter is not only the Corinthians, but he also talks about all the saints of Achaia, which is present-day Greece. Greece wasn't known necessarily as Greece then, but was known as the region of Achaia. You notice this in the very first verse of 2 Corinthians 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the church of God, which is at Corinth, with all the saints who are in all Achaia. Okay, so we're not just talking about Corinth now, but the original readers of his second letter is also to the saints of the Greece area. Now, Corinth was part of Greece, okay, but now this letter is addressing the Greeks outside of the city of Corinth itself. Not just the church, but also the Greeks in and around Corinth, in all of the area of Achaia. Purposes behind his writing. Why did Paul write? Well, first of all, to give instruction in doctrine and practical exhortations. This is going to be a common denominator that we're going to find as we go throughout all of Paul's epistles, that he spends time talking about doctrinal issues, and then as he talks about those, deals with the practical areas of our life as we are followers of Christ as to how we apply those doctrinal issues to our lives and how we live them out. So 2 Corinthians is no exception. Also, he wanted to give further instructions for the offering that was gathered for the poor saints in Jerusalem. This is where chapters 8 and 9 come in. And Paul gets very specific now with regard to what he's expecting them to do, as Titus will be there to finish off the fundraising project that he started about a year before. And he tells them how he wants them to respond, and that basically what Paul tells the Corinthians is keep digging deeper, okay? And makes no apology for it. He just says it matter-of-factly. And so those are further instructions that he gives in his second letter. He also wanted to make an extended defense of his apostleship, because again, there were false accusations by some in the Corinthian church. They were challenging him with regard to his authority, and so that's another reason or purpose behind the writing of this letter. What's interesting about this letter as well, when we read it, is it reveals for us different styles and characteristics in his writing. For example, when Paul in this letter assumes the role of the shepherd of the flock, right, the pastor to the church at Corinth, during these times, his style is what we would call placid and relaxed. He's not uptight. He's not getting passionate. He's being what we might call very pastoral, right? Very placid, very relaxed in his shepherd role in that part of the letter. But when Paul defends his apostleship, his style changes. His words rush along like a mighty flood. And if you were to go back into the original language of the letter as it's written, you find that what Paul does is it's almost as if he's writing about as fast as he possibly can, because his passion has taken him away. In fact, there are some sentences here, if we were to put punctuation into those sentences, remember, there were no punctuation marks used in the letters, because remember, Paul would write in such a way that he would get as many words as he possibly could in the minimal amount of space possible, right? And so if we were to put punctuation in some of these sentences, his sentences go on and on and on and on and on before you even get possibly to the end of a particular sentence. He is so passionate, and he is so on the defensive that his words just almost, they almost pile up on top of each other, okay? And there's certain areas in that letter where you're going, wow, when you begin taking a look at all of the verbs and the adjectives that he's using and so on, you're kind of going, whew, this is a lot of stuff here. And this is what Paul does, is another part of his writing style. In fact, in this is what someone called it, this most letter-like of all the letters of Paul, okay? So when you read it, it's most like a letter that we would have in our day and age. This letter is intensely personal. This is where Paul becomes intensely personal. He reveals for the Corinthians his intimate joys. He also reveals the fears of his tender heart. And this is where Paul is the most open about himself and what's going on in his life. There's also a lot of contrasts in this epistle as well, where Paul will, for example, in chapter 3, he will draw out a contrast between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, okay? And he'll talk about what is lacking in the Old Covenant that the New Covenant makes better, right? And so that's just one example of those contrasts that Paul brings out in this, this letter. So, this is where we find out most about Paul's heart, his struggles, his joys. This is where we find him passionate. This is where we find him being more pastoral. All those kinds of different styles, all wrapped up in those 13 chapters that we call 2 Corinthians. Comments or thoughts there before we get on to some other things?
You know, I really relate to that, Pastor. You know, I get, when I defend whatever I'm doing or how I'm feeling, I run. I get so many avenues of words.
Yeah.
And causes, and then into personal, and into revealing, and into fears, and then into defense.
Yeah.
What causes the person to do that?
It's our human condition.
And sometimes you go way too far. And you, whoa! And then you want to know.
Yeah. Back it up. Right. Yeah. No, it's our human condition, right? Yeah. And we see here in this letter Paul's human condition. Again, I think sometimes what happens when we take a look at these characters in the scriptures, and we saw this in the Old Testament, we'll see this again in the New Testament, where we put these characters that are described to us and introduced to us in the scriptures, and we put them up on pedestals where God never intended them to be. You know, Paul is almost godlike in some of our minds sometimes, when in actual fact, the only difference between Paul and ourselves basically is the time period in which he lived, far different from ours, okay? And Paul had the same human condition that you and I have, but as he talks about in his letters, and we'll see this as we go through, Paul talks about his struggles. He talks about his weaknesses. He talks about the things that he wished he would have changed. But Paul is one that is used of God as well, because God knew when he chose Paul for the ministry that he called him to, remember we saw that in Acts, when Paul was chosen, when God chose Paul, he was chosen with all those other things in mind. God wasn't surprised at any of what Paul did or said, because he knew what Paul was. He knew him intimately. Same with you and me. Now, again, that doesn't give us license to behave any way in which we want. And Paul would even say that. He says that specifically in Romans. He says, we don't have the freedom to go about and do whatever it is that we want. But the fact of the matter is that when God calls us, just as he did Paul, when God calls us, he calls us with the whole package in mind. He knows where we're strong. He knows where we're weak. When we submit to his authority, when we submit to his plan, that's when he begins to work in us in the ways in which he does, and that's when the changes take place in our lives that are necessary to take place. Paul's life changed as well. He wasn't the same man when he ended his ministry compared to when he began his ministry. It needs to be the same for us as well. And sometimes I think we forget that. I think we forget that sometimes. All right, any other thoughts?
When he was teaching his in Corinth, for that, like the time of would the same people have problem? I wonder if it was like a small Bible school, or how would they have done that when you're teaching the people all the...
Well, it would have been done in the church, okay, what would be constituted as a church. Now, how that was organized, whether or not they were in several locations or in one larger location, we don't have those details. But all of this was done in the city of Corinth itself, okay, in a particular location that was identified as the Church of Corinth. But that's about as much as we know. We haven't come across any old minutes from quarterly business meetings or anything from the Church of Corinth to be able to substantiate how they were organized. Let's talk about some of the prominent subjects of this letter. And the first one being, and this is where the majority of Paul's letter goes, is ministry of proclaiming Christ. Paul makes no apology for this at all. His first love was to preach the gospel of his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We can see that, especially when we take our minds back to Acts chapter 9, and then when Paul gives a defense of that conversion experience to the king, right? It was a dramatic experience. Paul had a dramatic conversion experience, one that is unique to him, one that was designed for him. And as a result of that conversion experience, this is what Paul loved to do. He couldn't stop preaching the gospel. And remember, we've already defined what the gospel is, right? Jesus came, Jesus died, Jesus rose again, and Jesus is coming again. That's the essence of the gospel, and that was the message that Paul kept preaching time and time and time again. Now, among his reasons for sharing these things with the Corinthians at the time were things such as this. Remember, their first contact with him was through his preaching. Remember, Paul was the one that got that church at Corinth started, okay? So, with getting that church started, he started with preaching the gospel, and he shared those things with the Corinthian people as he met them for the first time. His apostleship, and in connection with that then, his apostolic preaching, right? His apostleship was being challenged by some of them, okay? That was another reason behind sharing these things that he wants to share, especially the ministry of Christ. Also, Paul wanted to magnify the person of his preaching. The person, of course, being who? Jesus, right? He wanted to magnify the person of his preaching and clarify the methods of his preaching. Paul compared his preaching to some of the other preaching that was going on out there and talked about not just his preaching being the true gospel, but also challenging some of the other preaching that was going on out there that was not the true gospel. And we'll see this especially when we get into the next letter after we finish 2 Corinthians, when we get together again. He also wanted the Corinthians to learn important spiritual lessons applicable to what we would call the lay people, the common person in the church. And so these were important spiritual lessons not only for the lay people, but also for preachers that were in his churches that he was starting. Because why? They were both witnesses of this gospel, where Jesus came, Jesus died, Jesus rose again, and he's coming back again. Same message that Paul wants these preachers to be preaching. Same message that he wants the people of the church to be communicating. Because, again, remember, we're not looking at the church of Corinth as an accident or something that just happened to be, but Paul looks at placing a church and starting a church in a strategic center in the Roman Empire. What was strategically significant about Corinth? Remember, it was the center of commerce for this empire. It was a Roman colony. And so just as there was a church in Rome at the center of the empire, so there was a church now placed in the center of the commercial enterprise of this same empire. These churches weren't started by accident. They were started with an intent and a purpose to spread this gospel message of Jesus Christ. Another area that Paul talks about, of course, again, is Christian giving, chapters 8 and 9. This is what we call the New Testament's classic treatise on Christian giving. When we're going to talk about giving in the church, this is where we go. By the way, Sunday, we're going to be in this passage as we take a look at Christian giving in our own context here. And the setting is that of the fundraising project that the Corinthians had begun a year earlier. And so Paul spends some time helping the Corinthians understand the importance of this area of our Christian lives. He deals with his ministry credentials, chapters 10 through 13. Those four chapters, okay, compose, we estimate, about 30% of his entire letter. So about a third of his letter. What is Paul doing? He's vindicating his apostolic ministry. Why? Because the instigators of opposition to Paul were men from outside the Corinthian fellowship who were trying to lure some of those Christians away from their loyalties, and they were trying to plant seeds of doubt into the minds of those that were part of the Corinthian church. Just the same as one might try around here, right? To plant seeds of doubt with regard to my ministry here and all the rest of that. Same kind of idea of what's happening in Paul's setting there. And so he takes a good third of his letter to vindicate his apostolic ministry. Some other things that we find in this letter, some biographical notes about Paul that we don't see anywhere else in the New Testament. For example, Paul's escape from Damascus. Paul talks about that in his letter, his second letter to the Corinthians, where he has to escape for his life from Damascus, which is interesting because where was Paul converted?
Damascus.
Okay. All right. Paul here in this letter talks about his revelations and visions that he has. I was caught up into the third heaven, right? And he talks about those things. This is where Paul talks, of course, about his thorn in the flesh, okay? Which we think probably was something having to do with, I think, probably an eye ailment of some type or sort, okay? There's all kinds of ideas, different ideas out there as to what it was, but I think most of the evidence weighs in that area. Here also, Paul talks about his five Jewish scourgings, whippings. Not only that, but he had two Roman scourgings on top of that, as well as three shipwrecks. And that's just the beginning of the list of all of the perils that he went through. It's here in 2 Corinthians that Paul talks about those things that he received as a result of this message that he has been preaching, this gospel message, the fact that Jesus came, Jesus died, Jesus rose again, and he's coming back again for his own. All these things we see in Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. Some other important subjects that he deals with, he talks about the Old and New Covenants, and he contrasts them. We talked about that a little earlier. To see the full extent of that, read chapter 3. He talks about Christ's substitutionary atonement in this letter, whereby Christ is the substitute for us. Notice it in verse 21. It's the last verse of 2 Corinthians chapter 5. He writes, "For he made him, he being God, made him, Jesus Christ, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." So Paul brings about that substitutionary atonement idea. When you read through the scriptures, you'll find that there's many examples or pictures that are used in the scriptures to describe God's atoning for sin and his atonement of humanity. It's here in Paul, in 2 Corinthians, where he talks about the model of the substitutionary atonement of Christ, where Christ takes my place in dealing with the penalty of sin. It's here where he will also talk about the gospel of reconciliation. And let's go up a little further in chapter 5 of the same letter, 2 Corinthians 5:18. "Now all things are of God, who has," notice, "reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation." Notice it's the fourth time that word reconciliation is mentioned in that passage, and we haven't stopped yet. Verse 20, "Now then, with this ministry of reconciliation, We are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, here's it is the fifth time, be reconciled to God. Okay, so Paul brings out that important distinction for us to understand. With this substitutionary atonement, what is God doing? He's reconciling us to himself. Okay? We cannot do anything to bring ourselves back to God. It's what God has to do for us. God reconciles us to himself. We can't reconcile ourselves to God. He must reconcile us to him. And he does that through the substitutionary atonement of Jesus Christ. It's here in this letter, too, where Paul will talk about even the separation from worldliness, where he will challenge the Corinthian people about how they are living their lives, how they are conducting their lives, and what it is that they need to change. In fact, it's here where Paul talks about in 6:14, do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? Okay? This is that section where he talks about those issues. So, as much as we found last week that 1 Corinthians is indeed an important letter and deals with some specific issues that are happening within the church, even in 2 Corinthians, we find that Paul continues to challenge and encourage the church in how they walk with God. Thoughts there? Questions there before we get on to the last question part?
Can you define the word yoked for me?
Yeah, brought together. It gives us the picture of back in the days of Paul where you would have a team of oxen, right, that would be used to plow ground. They would be yoked together, right? There would be a yoke placed upon their necks so that they would work together, okay? That's the term yoked that Paul uses there. That's the picture that he's given, that we're not working together with unbelievers in that sense, okay?
Yeah. You had the case like when I met my wife.
Right.
She was a Christian, I was a non-Christian.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And actually, we should not have been yoked together.
It is a violation of what Paul encouraged the Corinthians with here, right? Yeah. Now, fortunately, by God's grace, what happened?
It worked.
It worked out. But that's not the, shall we say, the preferred
The hard way.
Yeah, it's the hard way. That's right. Yeah, the hard way. Good, good. All right, any other questions, thoughts there? Now let's get to that final question. You know what it is. You've been here often enough. You know I end with this question all the time. So what? There's five things that I want us to see here that brings about the significance of 2 Corinthians 4. Not that I don't think you would think that this letter is not significant for us, but that we've already talked about some of those things. But let's itemize, I think, five things for us here to help us see its significance maybe more clearly. 2 Corinthians teaches us, first of all, about the suffering and trials of Christians. Why? Because Paul talks about his suffering. Paul talks about his trials. Unfortunately, what's happened from time to time is that people have made this kind of statement. Give your life to Christ and your life will never be the same. You'll never have any more troubles or struggles. That's a lie. It's an absolute lie.
Well, the first part isn't, is it?
The first part isn't. It'll change your life. But oftentimes what we find is that we're dealing with stuff now in life that we never would have had to deal with if we had not turned to Christ. Okay? Paul, with all of his giftedness, being chosen specifically by God to do the ministry to the Gentiles that God wanted him to do, this was not a cakewalk for him. If we want to see what it's like to suffer in ministry, take a look at the Apostle Paul. Well, we could take a look at others, of course, too, but the Apostle Paul is one that we especially want to go to, especially in this letter when he begins to itemize the stuff that he went through for the gospel. Five times whipped by the Jewish leaders. Three times whipped by the Roman leaders. He couldn't seem to get on a boat without making it sick. Three shipwrecks in the process of his ministry. And that's not even mentioning all of the other trials. You know, brought up before Roman authorities, accused of all kinds of things, having to escape for his life through a window in a basket out of Damascus. Who would have thought of signing up for this, right? Paul is that example for us as to the fact that, you know what, just because we are followers of Christ does not mean that we will not have to deal with suffering and trials in life. In fact, we most likely probably will, because of our allegiance to Christ. Remember what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, it's recorded for us. Blessed are you when people revile you and say all kinds of evil things against you, right? Because, why are we blessed? Because we understand this is part of the territory of following Christ. Okay? So 2 Corinthians teaches us some good lessons about this. It also teaches us about death and the afterlife. Just as Paul talked about this in the last chapter of 1 Corinthians, it's here in this letter that he talks about death and the afterlife as well, especially when he begins in chapter 12 talking about these visions and revelations that he has about this third heaven and seeing things that he had not seen before, and God showing him and giving him glimpses of things that no one else had seen before. Paul gives us a little bit of idea about death. He gives us a little bit of idea with regard to the issue of even the afterlife. 2 Corinthians also teaches us about being ambassadors for Christ. It's here where he makes it very clear for the reader of the letter. Because you are a follower of Christ, you are a representative. That's what ambassador means. He uses that, again, he uses that word back in chapter 5, verse 20, right? Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, he says in verse 20 of chapter 5. What does he mean by that? You are representing Jesus Christ. When people see you, they need to be seeing Christ. Why? Because you're his ambassador. If a person comes up to you and says, who is Jesus Christ? You should be able to say, watch me. I'm his ambassador. Oh, that kind of sticks close to home, doesn't it? Right? When we begin to take a look at some of those things. And 2 Corinthians teaches us about that. That's why he gets later going on later into chapter 6 about how they're conducting their lives and so on. If we're ambassadors for Christ, we better be living like Christ would live. 2 Corinthians also teaches us about Christian giving. Okay? And we need to be taught about this. Why? Well, again, as you've heard me say before, giving is such a personal issue, isn't it? When we begin talking about money, possessions, that's when we start to squirm and squiggle because we're dealing now with personal issues. What do you mean? Well, I need to be thinking about this and that and the other thing with regard to my money and possessions. Well, again, what Paul does for the Corinthians gives us some good lessons with regard to how we need to respond and give as well. It's here where he talks about the cheerful giver, right? Rather than the one who gives under compulsion. I'm giving because, okay, if I don't, what's it going to look like? And, you know, all the rest. No. We're giving with joy. We're giving with cheerfulness. The word hilarious in our English language is the direct word related back to how Paul describes the cheerful giver. When you go back into the Greek language, we translate it in our English hilarious. Okay. So some things there that Paul teaches us in that area. Also, 2 Corinthians teaches us how to deal with false accusations and false teaching. Why? Well, because Paul was dealing with that in his own life. And what is interesting, as you begin reading it from this perspective, you know, teach me, Paul, about how to deal with false accusations and false teaching. You'll find that, Paul does some interesting things in response. We're also surprised on some of the things he does not do in response. That would be some of our own first reactions if we found ourselves in the same spot that Paul found himself in. So, teaches us how to deal with false accusations and false teaching. So, as much, I think, as 2 Corinthians kind of gets second billing in comparison to 1 Corinthians, I'm hoping that what we've done tonight in our review of 2 Corinthians is it's brought that second letter perhaps up a notch. So that it's a little closer to understanding that, you know what, this second letter that is preserved for us has as much value in it as that first letter that perhaps we're much more familiar with. I mean, let's be honest. Which letter are we more familiar with? The first Corinthian letter or the second Corinthian letter? Usually we would have to say the first. Tonight, hopefully what we've done is we've whetted your appetite just enough to bring that place where the second Corinthian letter now that's preserved for us is seeing a new light in our emphasis in our scripture reading. Anyway, there is 2 Corinthians for us to be benefit from, and we will pick it up again next time when we get together and talk another one of Paul's epistles. So let's pray together. Father, thank you again for your words, what it means to us, how it challenges us, how it helps us to grow. Father, keep us faithful, we would pray. And may your word continue to be that which encourages, challenges, and makes us fit for serving you. We pray it in Jesus' name.